Hello everyone. Today we are going to talk about a very important issue, that is banking reforms in India. The entire video has been created keeping in mind the coverage as in Yojana's January 2018's issue, and therefore we are going to cover major topics and major issues which have been discussed in January 2018 issue of Yojana related to banking reforms. You can subscribe to my free video course which is available on my website, that is www.anujindal.in. This free 20-day course is going to help you understand how exactly the course is covered and what all things are taken into consideration while covering the course. So let's start with the lecture and understand how are we going to cover the entire banking sector. We are going to briefly talk about the history as given in Yojana itself. We'll then move forward and talk about challenges for banking sector, which the banking sector is facing right now. Then we'll talk about impacts and possible solutions. So whatever challenges the banking sector is facing, whatever we are going to discuss, we are going to discuss about their impacts as well as possible solutions along with those challenges. Then we'll talk about future of banking in India. And after that, we'll cover the private versus public banks. So the reason for dominance of public sector banks over private sector banks will be discussed, and how private sector banks are coming forward and competing very efficiently with public sector banks, that is also going to be discussed. In the entire discussion, we are going to take a lot of facts also which have been mentioned in Yojana. And the reason that I'm going to focus a lot on facts is because RBI as well as NABARD ask facts very regularly which are not asked in UPSC examination. Certain additional topics which we are going to cover are financial inclusion, cybersecurity and insolvency. So these are also challenges as well as solutions related with banking sector, and these have been mentioned separately in Yojana. Therefore, we are going to discuss them one by one separately. So let's start with our discussion. First of all, let's take certain questions as we always do. The answer of these questions are going to be discussed at the end of this lecture. Right now, we are going to just have a look at the possible questions that can be asked from something that we are going to cover in this lecture. These questions will help you understand the kind of questions that can be asked and how are you supposed to study or how are you supposed to develop your outlook when you are dealing with any kind of topic that you're studying. The first question is, what was the name of the committee formed in 1991 for reforms in banking and financial industry of India? So it is asking simply, it's a very factual question, the name of the committee which was formed in the year 1991 for reforms in banking as well as financial industry. Certain choices are given: Committee on Financial Services, Committee on Banking Sector Reforms, Committee to Review Governance of Boards of Banks in India, and Committee on Banking and Financial Systems of India. If you know the name of the committee, that is the only way to write the answer or find out the answer. Otherwise, there is no other way to actually figure out what can be the answer of this particular question. The next question is, what are the challenges faced by Indian banking system presently? So this is a generic question which can be answered even with your present knowledge or generic knowledge about banking system in India. The choices are high NPAs, capital shortfall, lack of good governance, over-reliance on banking system for funds, and lack of social responsibility. So we will have a look at the choices, answer choices, and we'll try and solve this question when we are done with the entire chapter on banking system. The next question that we have is, what is the approximate exposure of top 100 large borrowers in NPAs of banks in India? Now, this is an interesting question because it's very factual in nature, and such factual questions are not exactly asked in UPSC or any other examination, but NABARD and RBI are the only two papers which ask these kind of questions. These kind of questions are also useful in various other banking exams like SBI or IBPS, or even SSC might ask these kind of questions, but not very regularly do they delve into banking systems of the country or the financial systems. The next question that we are going to discuss after we are done with the lecture is, which of the following is correct with respect to liability in case of a cyber fraud? So when we are going to talk about cyber security in India, we will also talk about cyber fraud, and therefore we will have a clear understanding about the liability clause that is there in the cyber security laws of India, and therefore only then will we be able to answer this kind of question. The next question that we have is, the following are categories of haircuts, identify the incorrect one. So unless you do not know the definition of haircuts as well as the meaning of the haircuts, it's very difficult for you to answer this question. At the same time, it's a factual question which tests your factual understanding or your knowledge about certain facts related to haircuts. Therefore, just an understanding of the meaning or definition of haircuts might not help you answer this question. Therefore, so we are going to discuss these kinds of facts also when we are going to talk about haircuts in India. So let's start with our first slide that talks about history of banking system in India. To talk about history, let's take very briefly nationalization, which took place in 1969. Banks with deposits greater than rupees 50 crore were nationalized, and total of 14 banks were nationalized in the year 1969. So although everybody, almost all of you would know that first phase of nationalization started in 1969, very less number of people among those who are going through this lecture would know that only banks with deposits greater than rupees 50 crore were nationalized in this particular year, and a total of 14 banks were nationalized. Nationalization also took place in the year 1980. This was the second phase of nationalization, wherein banks with deposits greater than rupees 200 crore were nationalized, and a total of 6 banks were nationalized in this time period. Now, this is also important because almost all of you are aware about the fact that nationalization happened in 1980 as well. But a very minor among you, a very small number of students among you would be aware that deposits greater than rupees 200 crore, banks which had deposits greater than 200 crore were the only ones which were nationalized. In 1991, a committee was established called as Committee on Financial Systems under M. Narasimham. So this was the first question that we picked up. So this is how you are able to, you can answer the questions by going through such factual information. Second is, in 1998, another committee on banking sector reforms was also created under M. Narasimham again. The recommendations of these committees have already been discussed in the course, and therefore I am not discussing them again here. In 2014, a committee on to review governance of boards of banks in India was created under PCNIC, and the recommendations of this committee can be accessed through the internet. We are not going to discuss the recommendations of these committees because they have already been discussed in other lectures. Now let's directly jump in onto the challenges which the banking sector presently faces. First and most important one is level of NPAs. So because of people like Vijay Mallya, the level of NPAs in India has gone very high. Second is, what exactly is the meaning of financial debt? We're going to understand very briefly the meaning of financial debt and the level of financial debt in India and what needs to be done. Thirdly, we are going to talk about high concentration of public sector banks in India. And how do we overcome this particular problem? How do we encourage or incentivize private sector banks to give proper competition or challenge to public sector banks? Capital requirements as per Basel III, we've already discussed this twice in two videos which are available on YouTube. So let's first of all talk about challenge number one, which is related with NPAs. What is an NPA? We've already discussed that in another video, so I'm not going to talk about that. What is twin balance sheet problem? We have already discussed that as well. So we are not going to repeat the same thing and talk about that. We're going to talk about something else. And that something else is facts related with NPAs. So you all know what exactly are NPAs. What are the provisions or features of NPAs under which, when exactly is a particular loan qualified as an NPA? Now the share of large borrowers in NPAs in India. Number one, borrowers with limit of 5 crore and above are a total of 56%, but their share in NPAs is a whopping 86.5%. So let's say there are 100 borrowers with a limit of 5 crore and above. This 100 borrower is 56% of the entire borrower. For example, let's say there are total of 100 borrowers in the market. Let's make it easier. So 56 borrowers would be the ones which have a limit of 5 crore and above. But their share in the entire NPA market, which means that if these 100 borrowers have an NPA of let's say 200 rupees, so the share of NPA, share of this 56% borrowers would be 86.5 into 2, that is 173 rupees. So out of this 200 of NPA, 173 rupees belongs to this 50% borrowers, which is borrowers with a limit of 5 crore and above, and therefore it needs to be remembered. Next is top 100 large exposures. So what are the facts related with top 100 large exposures? Share in borrowing, 15.2% of gross advances, but share in NPAs, 25.6%. So these 100 large exposures to NPAs have a share 100 large exposures to borrowers borrowing have a share in NPA of 25.6%, but their share in borrowing is only 15.2%. So let's say 100 rupees has been lent out. These 100 large borrowers have taken a total loan of 15.2 rupees because their share in borrowing is 15.2% of the gross advances. But their share in NPAs is 25.6%. Let's say out of these 100 rupees, rupees 50 total, a total sum of 50 rupees is NPA. This is NPA. This is gross advance. So out of this NPA, 25.6%, 25.6% or half of 25 would be 12.8 rupees is actually NPA belonging to this 15.2% of the population of the 100 large exposures, 100 large borrowers. So this is very interesting and very important fact that you need to remember related to NPAs. Now let's understand the reasons behind NPAs that have been provided in Yojana and also that I have found out from various other sources. Number one is lending to unworthy borrowers. So first of all is when the bank lends to unworthy borrowers or subprime borrowers or the borrowers whose chances of paying back is very less, then the chances of that particular borrowing becoming or turning into NPA increases. So let's take an example to understand this. Let's say this is a person who has a job which pays him 20,000 per month. Now he goes to the bank, he has high hopes and he wants to live a very rich life. So he goes to the bank and he says, I want a car. Let's say I want a Tata Safari, which costs, let's say 15 lakh rupees. And the monthly EMI of this Safari is, let's say 20,000 itself. So the EMI of this car is equal to whatever this person earns in his entire month. So he becomes a subprime borrower because there is no chance or there is no possibility that this particular person is going to be able to repay his loans. Because when he buys this car, his EMI is going to be 20,000 and all he gets every month is 20,000 only. There is no legal or illegal any other method that this person has in order to earn any extra money. So this is the only borrowing that he does, that he gets in an entire month. And this is the expense that he's taking by taking a loan from the bank in order to buy a car, which is not going to increase his income very fast for any other reason. So therefore, this particular person becomes an unworthy or a subprime borrower because there is no chance that he is going to be able to repay his loan. So after 1 month, after 2 months, whatever savings he has, he's going to use those savings, but after some time, he's going to default. And therefore, this is a case of lending to unworthy borrowers. Before 2008, there was a lot of lending to unworthy borrowers because the market was doing well, because everybody was earning money. And therefore, banks were very lenient about spending money or about lending money to borrowers who had very less chances or negligible chances of paying back the loan. Second is funds were borrowed to create excess capacity, anticipating excessive demand in the future. So this is another very important reason wherein what exactly happened before 2008 was that the global as well as domestic market were doing very well and everybody was earning a lot of money and the market was growing very, very fast. Not only the financial market, but also the asset market or real asset market as well as the consumer market. All these markets were growing very fast and therefore the companies anticipated that the markets are going to keep growing and they wanted to increase their capacity in order to earn even more money. For example, there is a small company which produces, let's say, local computers. So this is a company which assembles local computers, and because there is a boom in the market, a lot of small companies are coming up, a lot of IT companies are flourishing, are coming up every day. Therefore, they anticipate that the demand for computers is, let's say, going to increase from 100 computers per day to 200 computers per day in the next 2 years. This is their forecast, this is their anticipation based on the present level of the market. And therefore, in order to be able to increase their production, or their assembling capacity from 100 to 200, they are going to take a loan from the bank. And when they take a loan from the bank. The loan is dependent upon this forecast that they have made that the market is going to expand and their demand for their product, for their computers, is going to increase sharply from 100 to 200 computers per day. Now, what happened? 2008 financial crisis stuck, and this demand reduced further from 100 to 50, or let's say from 100 to 20. So whatever forecast they had made, that actually turned out to be wrong. And whatever loan they had taken for excess capacity, for creation of excess capacity to be able to buy more machines, to be able to hire more people, all that went into vain, all that went into the dustbin. And therefore, these companies started shutting down, or these companies started producing less in order to survive. And they were not able to pay back the loans that they were supposed to these banks. So this was another reason. Third is, project completion has been delayed in many infrastructure, especially infrastructure as well as real estate projects, because of structural problems in the economy. They are not able to get clearances from the government very easily. For example, if a tender for making road has been passed and it has been provided to a company, now the company is supposed to create or produce or manufacture that particular road in a time of, let's say, 2 years, a stretch of 200 kilometers in 2 years. Now, even after getting the tender, it is becoming difficult for that company to be able to, let's say, acquire land in order to create that road. Acquisition of land is becoming a problem, and the reason behind that is structural problems. The government came out with the tender, the government auctioned the tender, gave the pass to one specific company, but the problem of acquisition of land was not solved. Now, this is because of structural problems in the economy. The laws are so difficult that everything goes to the court. Whatever the government is trying to do is being stopped in the court, or it takes a lot of time in order to get clearances because of various structural problems, whether legal or institutional. The fourth one is improper due diligence. So whatever we discussed in point number two, due diligence is checking whether this small company is doing well or not on a regular basis. So if this company took this loan in, let's say, the year 2005, and for the next 3 years it kept working very well, or let's say till 2007 it was working well, but after that it started declining. So due diligence was not available at that time, or was not paid heed to by these banks, and they failed to recognize that these companies are actually falling down, are actually not doing that well, or are going to do badly because of certain upcoming problem. So due diligence with respect to loans that had been forwarded to many companies was not carried out. And diversion of funds was a very big issue. Many companies, this particular company itself, let's take the same example, this company took money in order to buy more computer, in order to buy more machinery to be able to assemble more computers. But instead, it spent that money on acquiring another company which makes computers. So instead of acquiring or increasing its assembling capacity, it decided to acquire another company. Now, that is a diversion of funds, because if the bank is not intimated in advance before taking the loan that this is how the company is going to spend that money, then it is a case of diversion of funds. So these are all the reasons for high NPAs in India. There are a lot of other reasons, but these are the major reasons that are responsible for high NPAs in India. Now, very important issue that we need to discuss is why NPA took time to show in the balance sheets as well as books of banks. The reason for that is, before 2008, when the advances or the denominator, so NPA is money that is not being paid upon the total money that is being paid. So the advances, let's say the gross NPA is here, and the credit growth, the gross NPAs are here, and the credit growth is here. So as you can see, before 2008, the credit growth was actually very high. The credit growth was, it was going up very fast. It was actually very, very high compared with the level of NPAs. Now the NPA started coming up, and at the same time the credit growth started dropping. So the NPAs show only when the denominator also drops. So what happened before 2008 was that although the number of NPAs might have been very high, they were not showing because the credit growth was very fast or very, very high. So this can also be seen through this particular graph or chart, which shows that the credit growth was above 10% in this entire time period, even in this entire time period. And before 2008-09, it was so high at double digits, almost above 20%. At the same time, the gross NPAs were almost in the range of 2 to 3%, and they spiked in the year 2015-16 and 16-17 when the credit growth started going down. And at the same time, the NPAs started going up. All the people who were trying to pay back to the banks actually decided not to pay because of one or more reasons. So this is the major reason that NPAs take time to show. So this kind of question, they can be question framed on this and can be asked in phase two, or a question can also be framed in the interview because it checks your conceptual understanding as to why NPAs took so much time to show in the books of banks. Certain facts related with NPAs. What is the impact of willful default? So if a person or a company or an institution decides to default on its repayments to the bank, what can be the implications? Number one, imprisonment for a term between 6 months to 10 years. Fine amount of fraud to 3 times the fraud. So if the fraud is, let's say, rupees 100, then anything between rupees 100 to rupees 300 can be fined from this particular defaulter. The third is, if fraud involves public interest, then minimum imprisonment increases to 3 years. Otherwise, it is 6 months to 10 years. Fact two related to court order under SERFACE. SERFACE allows bankers to take possession of assets and auction them without intervention of the court. So a question can be framed wherein SERFACE, various provisions related with SERFACE may be asked. And this is one important provision that has been missed out from very many notes that have been made on SERFACE, which says that if the bank is going under SERFACE, then in order to auction the assets, it need not take any approval from the court, and the intervention of the court is also limited or prohibited. Only the debt recovery tribunal can actually intervene when SERFACE has been applied on any defaulting individual or institution. Now let's briefly talk about a second challenge, which is called as the challenge of financial debt. Now before understanding or before going forward with financial debt, it's very important to understand the definition of financial debt. If we take an example to understand this, it would be easier. So financial debt is something like, for example, if the worth of economic output in an economy in a particular year is, let's say, only $100. So this is the entire value of economic output in the entire economy in 1 year. Now, compared with this $100 worth of economic output, what is the worth of banks, financial institutions, and markets? For example, in this example itself, let's say the size of banks in terms of money, the size of financial institutions, and the amount of money, amount of capital which has been invested in financial institutions as well as markets is, let's say, $50. So the financial debt of the economy becomes 50% when compared with the worth of or value of economic output in the economy. So this is what is called as financial debt. The size of banks, financial institutions, and markets relative to the economic output in the economy is called as financial debt. What is the positive impact of financial debt? There are two major positive impacts. Number one, it leads to or results in economic growth of the economy because of more financial activity. It's as simple as that. You have more financial activity, you have more borrowing and lending activities, you have more investment as well as financing in the economy, and that results in more economic growth in the economy. And second is poverty alleviation. Now, this is an indirect impact of financial debt, which results from more employment opportunities in the economy, which are a result of more lending and borrowing and more investment and financing activities in the economy. For example, if there is financial debt in the economy, which means it's easier and there is easy access of money in the economy, and I want to create my own startup. So when I create my own startup, I need, let's say, $10,000. So when I need this $10,000, I can go to the financial market and borrow this very easily. So I get it at an interest rate of, let's say, 6%. I go on and borrow this money, and I set up a small factory and I start producing my own products. Now I start producing. In order to produce something, I need labor, I need employment. So I hire a set of 3 people. So this is creating employment in the economy, and these people, if they are poor, they are coming out of poverty. So this indirectly results in poverty alleviation for the economy. Now let us talk about the third challenge, which is the challenge of concentration of public sector banks in the Indian banking system. Now let me tell you that this particular challenge is now getting resolved. Now the private sector banks are also coming ahead very fast in terms of credit intensity as well as other numbers, and the reason for that is public sector banks are facing problems because of high NPAs, and therefore they are not able to provide marginal or additional credit at a speed that they were supposed to. Certain facts which tell us that the concentration of public sector banks has been very high, and also certain facts which are telling us that now this trend is changing. So first of all, public sector banks hold 70% of total assets in the economy. So this is very important. Of all the financial assets in the economy, 70% are held by public sector banks or are invested in public sector banks. Secondly, per capita dollar income of the country is about to touch 2000 mark, which is a very good news, not directly connected with concentration of PSPs, but a very good news and very important for you to remember. Deposit penetration, what is the meaning of deposit penetration? Value of deposit as a percentage of GDP, and this is presently at 61%. This means that whatever deposit has been made in the economy, as a percentage of GDP, it is at 61%. Very less compared with other countries like China, Vietnam, as well as advanced countries, but still at a very comfortable level. Second is credit intensity, which is very less, which means credit needed for an additional unit of output. So it is 45% of GDP growth. So every $1 or 1 rupee of GDP growth requires 45% of it. That means 45 cents of, if it is 1 rupee, then 45 paisa coming out from credit. Private banks have 29% share in outstanding credit. So whatever outstanding credit is there in the economy, in the financial economy right now, 29% of that share is held by or belongs to private sector banks. But on the other hand, incremental credit, 75% belongs to private banks. This means that out of whatever additional $1 is being invested in the economy, is being raised in the economy as credit, 75% of that is being provided by private banks. So if in an economy a total of 100 rupees or $100 is being provided as credit to institutional as well as individual borrowers, then 75% of it is being provided by private banks. Now this is very important. This shows that the issue of concentration of public sector banks is actually turning around, is actually shallowing, is actually reducing with time, and private sector banks are also coming up. So what are the major reasons for increase in market share for private sector banks? We discussed that market share of private sector banks is increasing, but what are the reasons behind it? Number one, adoption of technology. As you all know, private sector banks are much advanced compared with public sector banks when it comes to adoption of latest technology, whether it is about phone related technologies, Android apps, or various other different kinds of credit cards that are being introduced, touch and go cards, debit as well as credit cards. All these things are implemented and adopted faster by private sector banks compared with PSPs. Productivity, that means cost to income ratio. This means cost here means employee expenditure plus operating expenditure, and income here means net interest and other income. So the cost to income ratio of public sector banks is much higher than private sector banks, which means that for earning every $1 of income, public sector banks, PSBs, are investing or are spending much higher cost compared to private sector banks. This gives private sector banks more money to invest further in their banks, and therefore more growth. With respect to employee, the compensation and retention policies of private sector banks are considered better than PSPs. And the last and very important one is early identification of stress. That public sector banks were not able to deal with the problem of NPAs because they were not able to identify the stress at a time when they should have. They were too late with identification and resolving the NPAs. And that is where private sector banks differ from PSBs. They are able to identify as well as resolve stress in a particular institution or an individual at a very early stage. And that is the reason that they are able to reduce their NPA numbers even with such high NPA problems in the economy. So these are the major reasons that market share of private sector banks is increasing day by day in the economy. Now let's have a brief look at future of banking in our economy. So there are a total of 8 factors which are responsible or which need to be kept in mind by the bankers and institutions if they want to grow in the future. Number one is demographics. So if banks want to grow, then they have to keep in mind the young and digitally equipped population that is there. If their demands are not met, then those banks are going to suffer. And secondly, future of banking is also good because these young and digitally equipped population is going to adopt to changes very fast and therefore make banking more tech savvy as well as more comfortable. Second is development, which has an important factor of financial inclusion. So if banks want to grow in the future, they cannot just keep themselves niche. They have to go outright into various rural areas also in order to expand themselves so that they can compete with the high-rising public sector as well as private sector banks. So that is number two. Financial intermediation is number three, which means deregulation, which means that institutionalization of the entire structure and function of banking is very important. So if the banking is supposed to grow in the future, then the activity of financial institution has to go forward with deregulation and self-regulation of banking system in the economy. Next is disruption, which means integration of banking, telecom and finance. So banking is going to move very fast towards universal banking. And at the same time, integration of banking with activities or with processes like telecom and finance. So banks which are not going to be able to adopt to this change will not be able to flourish, and banks which are going to be able to adopt to this change will grow very fast. There are 4 other elements in future of banking. These are omnichannel. Omnichannel means there will be technology-based integration, and there will be technology-based interaction between the customer and the bank, and this will be based on only one channel that is going to be technology based. So presently, or in the past few years, there have been very small branches, which are these branches were to be the primary channel of interaction between an individual and the bank. But now these branches are either closing down, or at least the level of interaction between the individual and the bank is becoming more dependent upon technology. For example, if now you want to take out money, rather than going to a bank, you go to an ATM or you just use internet banking. This means that you are using technology over the personal interaction that was available before in terms of branches. So omnichannel means that there is going to be only one channel of interaction between an individual and the bank. Second is innovation, which means majority of the utilities or the services which banks are going to provide are going to be outsourced. For example, ATM services will get outsourced. Credit card services are already outsourced. Similarly, debit card services and various mobile banking services, as well as various other services related with banking, are going to get outsourced and more specialized. This will give more chances or more legroom for innovation, because all these services are going to be provided by specialists who are going to be more innovative in their own fields. And therefore, the bank will innovate. And at the same time, all these services being provided by the banks will also improve very fast. Cashless and branchless banking is going to increase. And innovation in ATM usage, as put out by Yojana, through solar ATMs is going to increase penetration of ATMs into rural areas. So these are all future elements of banking in India. And if there is a question, then if there is an essay on future of banking or potential forecast related to banking in India, then all these points can be jotted down by you. There can also be a question, MCQ question, wherein different different elements can be provided, and you have to figure out what are the potential elements of future of banking. So all these are positive in nature, because banking is going to flourish, no doubt going to flourish in Indian economy after we are done, or after we have resolved the NPA problem which is presently being faced by the economy. So now let's talk about very important issue, that is recapitalization of banks. You must also gone through almost everything related with recapitalization, but there are certain doubts with students with respect to the concept of recapitalization, as to how is it supposed to work, and certain facts related with recapitalization that I'm going to tell you here. So first of all, the concept of recapitalization, how it is supposed to work, is that this is the government, this is a bank, and this is, let's say, financial market. So now the government is going to issue bonds, and when it issues bonds to these banks, it is going to receive money from these banks. Now these banks have a lot of piled up money which was received because of demonetization. So this money, which will be received by the government by issuing bonds from the bank, and then this money is going to be provided to another set of banks. Let's say this set of banks are the banks which are doing good, which have a lot of deposits. These are the sets of banks which are doing bad because of various NPA problems. And at the same time, there will be certain good banks also. So this money is going to be provided to the bad banks as well as good banks based on either performance or based on the need. So whatever money is going to be received by the government from the banks, which was piled up with these banks because of demonetization, is going to be provided, forwarded to good as well as bad banks based on performance as well as need. The banks can also, whatever money they receive, whatever bonds they receive, so the bonds are going to be issued to these banks which are going to provide money. These bonds can further be provided or traded in financial markets. So if these bonds are traded in financial markets, pushed forward into financial markets, the bank is going to receive money in return for these bonds. So this is the meaning, this is what means tradable. This means that the bond which is going to be issued by the government is going to be tradable. Now this issue has not been clarified yet. The banks might be allowed to trade these bonds further in the financial markets. The banks might not be allowed. If they are allowed, they will receive even more money, and that will allow them or enable them to come out of NPA problem even faster. So this is the entire issue of recapitalization of banks, how the bonds are going to work. Total recapitalization has been announced at 2.11 lakh crore. The breakup is very, very important. Budgetary support, which is going to be provided, is 18,000 crore. That is directly out of budget of the union government. Second is equity issuance. By the bank is going to issue equity, and the government is going to buy into that equity and invest 58,000 crore for additional capital. And the third is recapitalization bonds that I've just explained, which will be up to a limit of 1,35,000 crore, and this is going to be front-loaded. Front-loaded here means that this will be invested or this will be issued by the banks in the next few months only. So this is the meaning of front-loaded. Let's now talk about haircuts, which is also related with recapitalization of banks. So the definition of haircut says that it is the difference between loan amount. For example, if the loan amount is rupees 100 and the actual value of asset used as collateral. So this is one definition of haircut. So if you have used a collateral, the value of which is, let's say, 120 to be extreme, then the difference is haircut. Or it is normally less, so if it is 80, then the difference is haircut, that is rupees 20. Or if it is 70, then the haircut is 30 rupees. In the context of loan recoveries, it is the difference between actual dues from the borrower. For example, the actual dues from the borrower are 100 rupees and the amount he settles with the bank. That is, if he has already paid back rupees 30, then he needs to pay 70 rupees more. So this 70 rupees becomes the haircut. If he is not going to pay any more amount, any more money to the bank. Or if he has already paid, let's say the total loan was rupees 100, he's already paid rupees 30, and he settles that he's going to pay only rupees 30 more. So the haircut that the bank is taking, or the loss that the bank is incurring, is rupees 40 in this case. Banks may have to take haircuts to the tune of rupees 2,40,000 crore or 60% of their big loans. So this is the haircut. This is a fact that you need to remember, because this can also be asked in the examination. So according to RBI, there are a total of four categories of haircuts. These are the four categories: deep, aggressive, moderate, and marginal. Deep haircut is when more than 75% of the value of the loan is missed out or is uncovered. For example, if the loan is of rupees 100, and if let's say 76 rupees is not covered, not recovered, and only rupees 24 is recovered by the bank, then this becomes a deep haircut. Aggressive is when 50 to 75% is not recovered, moderate is 25 to 50, and marginal is when less than only 25% of the value of the loan is not recovered. So these facts are very important to remember. Let's now talk about financial inclusion. So I have divided the entire definition, or broken down the entire definition of financial inclusion here. Let's have a look at it, the different parts of the definition. It is the access to appropriate financial products and services. Now, what are these appropriate financial products and services? Banking, insurance, and capital markets. These are the three major financial products and services needed by all sections of society, especially the vulnerable groups. So this is important to remember. In the interview also, such questions have been asked. They normally ask you a simple question like, what is financial inclusion? So there, if you have already broken down the definition, it becomes easier to explain it to them. For example, you can tell them, sir, it is access to various financial products and services, by which I mean banking, insurance, and access to capital markets, which are required by all sections of society, especially the vulnerable groups, at affordable cost, in a fair and transparent manner, and provided by institutional players and not by informal players. So these are institutional as against non-institutional players, which are, for example, money lenders. So financial inclusion is complete only when it is the institutional players which are providing financial services to the people, and not the non-institutional players like money lenders or chit funds. These kind of non-institutional players are not providing these financial services to the people at large. So this is the definition of financial inclusion, broken down into different parts. Now let's move forward with more things related to financial inclusion. So these are certain facts or certain numbers which are very important, and you need to remember them. Number one, Census 2011 says that only 58.7% of households, 58.7% of the entire households in India, have access to financial services, formal banking services, and 54.4%, here it is mentioned, 54.4% of rural areas have access to formal banking services. 67%, almost 68% of urban areas have, urban households have access to banking, formal banking services. So all these three numbers are important to remember. Next is very important, institutional and non-institutional rural credit. So when we talk about rural credit, then 49.9% or almost 50% is provided by formal sources, the credit which is provided to rural areas, as against 33% which belongs to informal or non-formal sources. Latest fact related to Pradhan Mantri Jan Dhan Yojana, I've already discussed this somewhere else also in another video on ESI, but I'm discussing it again here. The number of beneficiaries are now total of 30.7 crore. And rural and urban is 18.1 and 12.7. Deposits is to the tune of almost 70,000 crore. And this is not very important, but you can still remember it. Number of RuPay debit cards is 23.1 crore. So this is what you need to remember. This particular sheet of fact is not very important. Next, the data that we have is very, very important. Targets and achievements for agriculture credit in India. This is important for both RBI as well as NABARD examination. So what it says is that a total of 10,658 billion rupees right now has been provided as agricultural credit, as against a target of 9,000 billion rupees. So the target of 9,000, but against this, 10,658 has already been provided in the year, has been provided in the year 2016-17 as agricultural credit. So this number is important. Next, here the numbers are not very important, but this in this particular sheet, you need to understand and remember what are the parameters of financial inclusion. So BS, BDA, basic savings, bank deposit account number 1, overdraft number 2, Kisan credit card number 3, general credit card number 4, information communication technology number 5, and we have banking correspondence number 6. So all these are parameters of financial inclusion which give us certain information about the progress on financial inclusion in India. Having discussed financial inclusion, let's now talk about some important things about insolvency and bankruptcy code. You must already be reading a lot about insolvency and bankruptcy code. Here I'm going to take certain things which are normally missed out and which are not covered by newspapers. So let's talk about certain facts and figures related with IBC. IBC shifts the responsibility to the creditor, number one. So there can be a question which can be created here to initiate insolvency resolution process against the corporate debtor. So it's not the debtor who has the responsibility or the government or any other bank, any other institution which has the responsibility. It is the creditor, whatever it might be. It might be an individual, or he or she might be an institution as well. NCLT adjudicates insolvency resolution for companies. So it is the National Companies Law Tribunal which adjudicates insolvency process for companies. Whereas if the insolvency process is for individuals, it is the Debt Recovery Tribunal which adjudicates. If default is over rupees 1 lakh, the creditor may initiate insolvency resolution process and go to NCLT directly. Time-bound resolution has been provided under IBC to be completed by NCLT within 180 days and extendable up to 90 days. For small companies, what do you mean by small companies? Which has a capital up to rupees 50 lakh and turnover up to rupees 2 crore, or an unlisted company with assets up to rupees 1 crore. So if there is a small company which is listed, then either its capital is up to 50 lakh or its turnover is up to rupees 2 crore, or there is a small unlisted company which has assets up to rupees 1 crore. So this is an acronym or a small chart that you have created. Then the time limit is 90 days plus extendable by up to 45 days. Otherwise it is 180 plus 90. So this is the division with respect to time bound resolution that we have created. There is a definition of insolvency professional also which has been provided in IBC. So at least 10 years of experience is required as a CA or a CS or a cost accountant or a lawyer or a person belonging in the field of management. So this is what is required mandatorily if you want to be an insolvency professional. A national insolvency examination is also to be required to be cleared by an insolvency professional. Let us now talk about something very important, which is the issue of cyber security, especially with respect to banking and financial transactions in the country. Digital transactions include the following. Number one, internet services. Number two, banking, mobile banking. Number three, debit and credit card transactions. Number four, card swipes. Number five, point of sale machines. Number 6, UPI, number 7, QR code, and number 8, last, touch and go card. So these are all parts or elements of digital transactions in India and around the world also. So these are the stakeholders which are included or which are a part of cyber security in digital transaction in India. Number 1 is customer or originator. Firstly, you have the customer or the originator. So it is the responsibility of the customer or the originator to ensure that he or she is following all the laws and all the rules which ensure security on the cyber front. Number 2 is originating institution. That is the institution through which he can make the transaction. Number 3, transaction processing agency. The agency which processes his transaction. For example, InstaMojo is a processing agency. For example, RazorPay, or you must have seen CC Avenue, which is used by Amazon. So all these are processing agencies. Number 4 is beneficiary institution, the institution which is going to transfer the money finally to the beneficiary. For example, the beneficiary bank, and finally is the beneficiary. So all these are stakeholders, and all these stakeholders have some or the other responsibility in ensuring that cybersecurity is maintained mm-hmm. when they are a part of digital transactions or taking a digital transaction. Next is certain latest developments with respect to cybersecurity. Number one, Cyber Swachhata Kendra. So it is a botnet cleaning and malware analysis center which has been created recently under Certain. Certain has launched Cyber Swachhata Kendra to protect against botnet infections. So this is all that you need to remember about Cyber Swachhata Kendra. Samvid is another one. It is a desktop based application whitelisting solution. You need to remember this keyword, application whitelisting solution, which allows only pre-approved apps to run on your desktop. So it is basically securing desktops, especially in financial institutions like banks, so that only pre-approved apps are able to run. For example, if you have a desktop in a bank, you cannot run social media websites like Facebook or let's say WhatsApp desktop. All these cannot be run in the desktop in banks because they are secured by somewhere. Next is mKavach, protection against malware for Android mobile phones. And next is BrowserJS Guard, protect against browser based attacks which come from your browser. For example, if you're working on Chrome, Google Chrome, then there are certain attacks which come from these browsers. So BrowserJS Guard is to protect against those. So all these names and their primary purpose, that is all that you need to remember. You need not get into details related to all these developments related with cybersecurity. The next is something very, very important. It has never been asked in the exam, but there are all possibilities because it's also mentioned in detail in Yojana as well. So Section 66 of Information Technology Act, it is very, very important because it is the one which guides our entire cybersecurity. All these are sections and subsections related with Section 66 of IT Act. So it's just important just to remember what is the purpose of each section and subsection. Section 66 talks about hacking with computer system. So if you are hacking with a computer system, then you are going to be charged under this section. Section 66B is charged for receiving stolen computer or communication device. C is for using password of another person, and D is for cheating using computer resource. So these all are subsections under Section 66 of IT Act. All these need to be remembered. Next is related with the grievance redressal in case of any cyber fraud that a consumer or a depositor experiences. First of all, there is zero liability and limited liability in case of cyber frauds. So there is either zero liability or limited liability depending upon all these provisions. Number one, if there is negligence of the bank, then there is zero liability of the consumer. If there is a third party breach, that means any other institution hacks over or takes over the system of the bank or system of the customer also, and this third party breach is responsible for any kind of cyber fraud without bank involvement, it is to be reported within 3 days. Only then will the customer get his money within 10 days. So if defrauded amount, if there is no involvement of the customer or the depositor or no negligence on the part of depositor, and if there is a third party breach, then the defrauded amount is to be credited back within 10 days. If the same report is done within 4 to 7 days, then customer will get only between ₹5,000 and ₹25,000, because then it becomes more and more difficult to identify as to why or the reasons for the breach. Let us now have a relook at the questions that we looked at the starting of the video. The first question was, what was the name of the committee formed in 1991 for reforms in banking and financial industry of India? So the answer is Committee on Financial Services. Committee on Banking Sector Reforms was created in 1998, also another under M. Narasimham. Committee to review governance of boards was under P.J. Naik. And this is something that I have created myself by combining the names of first and second committee. The answer is Banking Committee on Financial Services. Let us have a look at these next question. The question says, what are the challenges faced by Indian banking system presently? We already have read about all these challenges in the video. So the first challenge, high NPS, is yes, a very important challenge or a very serious challenge. The next is capital shortfall. This is also a challenge. Lack of good governance related with Basel guidelines. Lack of good governance, yes. Recently, Uday Kotak Committee has also come out with recommendations of good governance. Over-reliance on banking system for funds. Yes, we read about this also in over-reliance on PSBs or concentration of PSBs in India. Lack of social responsibility. This is not exactly a challenge because public sector banks have done very well when it comes to social responsibility. So the answer is A, B, C, and D, and not E. The next question is a factual question. It says, what is the approximate exposure of top 100 large borrowers in NPAs of banks in India? We've already gone through it in the video itself, and the answer is A, 25%. The next question says, which of the following is correct with respect to liability in case of a cyber fraud? So if there is a cyber fraud, which of the following is correct with respect to liability? Customer has zero liability in case of negligence of the bank. Yes, this is correct. If there is a third party breach without bank involvement, it has to be reported to the bank within 3 days. Yes, we just read about it. This is correct. If there is no fault on the part of customer or depositor, defrauded amount has to be credited back within 10 days. Yes, this is also correct. Customer cannot claim defrauded amount in case of lack of negligence on the part of the bank. There is not nowhere mentioned that if there is no negligence of the bank, customer cannot get back the refund amount, cannot get back the defrauded amount. Because even if there is no negligence on the part of the bank, and if bank systems are hacked without any fault of the customer, then the customer is bound to get his money back. And therefore, the answer is A, B, and C, and not D. The next question is, the following are categories of haircuts. We read about haircuts in the video itself. Identify the incorrect one. Deep is more than 75%. Yes. Marginal is, what is it? Is it 10 to 25%? We don't know. We are not very clear and we still have doubt about it. Moderate is 25 to 50. Yes. Aggressive, 50 to 75. Yes. Marginal is 0 to 25%. So these kinds of questions can also be created in the examination. Therefore, you need to remember all the facts very well. So we've gone through the entire video and we have understood a lot of great details about banking reforms in India. This was the coverage of Yojana's January 2018 edition, and a lot more things, important things were also being covered in the video through various other sources. If you like the video, please subscribe to my YouTube channel. You can also join the Telegram group for regular discussions, and there's a channel also in Telegram itself. The link to both the group as well as Telegram channel are available in the description section below.